Christ the Lord, the newborn King. Gloria, Gloria, Gloria to the promised one, to the only Son. Gloria, now the
done put me in the Christmas spirit. Right. Comfort and joy, all right. Okay, Jennifer, where are you at? Where you at, Jennifer? All right, come on. Come on, come on. Come on up here. Everybody want Jennifer, come on up here, clap your hands. Come on, atta girl. Atta girl, come on. She told me this morning she was ready to sing some Christmas songs. I said, okay, we'll go. Oh. Yeah. Mark's head's red already back there. Okay, let's all stand. We're going to sing, Oh Come All You Faithful. All right, that's 89 in your hymn book. 89, Oh Come All You Faithful. We're going to do it, Jennifer. Come on now. You got to help me. I'm so proud of her, aren't y'all? I am so proud of her. Do I? She's gonna sing with me. All right, everybody ready? Oh, come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Mark, you want to get a picture of this? Okay, that's all right. Sing choirs of angels, sing in exultation. Oh, sing all ye bright host of heaven above. Glory to God, glory in the highest. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Yea, Lord, we greet thee, born this happy morning. Jesus, to thee be all glory given. Word of the Father, now in flesh appearing. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. How about that?
That's great. You can be seated. Now see, the Lord's about to come back, y'all. Tammy, you want to come on up here? She wants to move her membership to be a part of Summertown Baptist Church. And if you sense it's the will of God that she be a part of this body, let you know I'm saying amen.
Amen.
Amen. Anybody opposed? Oh, me? That's good. Give her a hand. What a way to start a church service. Amen. Jennifer Pig singing. Wow. I can see it now. Let's see, there's Swifties, and now there's going to be piggies. I am too. I'll never forget when Bella was born. She'll kill me for saying this. When Bella was born, she called me and she said, well, now there's three little pigs.
Oh, and she always go, I don't know. Remember? I got that picture in my office. So, all right. Isn't it good just to be here tonight? Free spirit, the Lord is here. I'd like for you to turn to Psalm 119. We're learning the Hebrew alphabet. What's the first letter in the Hebrew alphabet? Aleph. What's the second letter? Beth. That's exactly right. Remember the piano player. That's all you got. Not Will, but Beth is what you got to remember. So, and I want to just kind of share. I just think it'd be great to go through Psalm 119, and I hope that you're blessed. We'll do it one alphabetical term at a time. Aleph we did last week, and Beth. And if you'll realize that Psalm 119 holds one thing superior high than anything else, and that's the Word of God. I can't think of anything better in a society that we live in today than to ground ourselves completely and truly and faithfully to the Word of God in every aspect of life. And the scripture is, this Psalm 119 is so powerful. And I don't believe that the writer wrote it, just sat down and wrote it continuously from verse 1 all the way through the last part. And of course, we know he didn't write it in verses and chapters. He didn't break it off that way. I think that there was a lot of contemplation about it while he was writing it. And what this psalm really is, this is a psalm of a heart of a man, a young man especially, but the heart of a man that just is opened up in honesty and integrity before God and in rawness before God. And basically he's saying, here I am, and I want to be what you want me to be. And I know I can only be that if I follow the Word of God. The Word of God is superior to anything else that the world has to offer. I know that education is important and we should pursue an education. I know that vocations are important and we should do the best we can possibly do in our vocations. Families are important and we should do the very best we can do with families. But if we do the best we can in all of those areas without the Word of God, we're no better than anybody else in the world. And it's not that we're trying to be better than anybody else in the world. It's the fact that we get the benefit of a blueprint on how to be a student, on how to be a parent, on how to be a father, how to be a mother, how to be a child. We have the answers right here in the Word of God. And as we study the Word of God, especially in Psalm 119, we find out that the Word of God leads to a specific venue of life, a venue of thought, a venue of language, a lot of different things. And I like that a lot because then we can compare. You'll see the word according, and I shared that a little bit this morning in Sunday school. The word according is a very important thing because it means that there's a standard. And the standard is set by the Jehovah God himself. And everything that we should do should be according to what God has said. He's the creator, and we can do according to what he says. And I love his according because his according is to call us into. And when the Word of God reveals things to us in our lives, again, remember, it's never to beat us up, it's to better us up. It's to show us according to the Word of God, where God wants us to be and possibly where we are, whether it be falling short or whether we be on plumb level with the Word of God. But Psalm 119 is a powerful text of Scripture, and I just sense that this is where the Lord wants us to camp out for some time in Psalm 119. Verse 9, he's asking diagnostic questions, and Psalm 119, 9 and 11 are two of the very first seven verses of Scriptures that I ever memorized as a young man. I was 20 or 21 years old when I memorized these verses of Scripture, so I've known them for over 40 years. And they're very, very important to me, and I quote them very often. There's power in the Word of God, and the Word of God is timeless. The Word of God is pure and true. And I didn't memorize it in New American Standard, but I will read it in the New American Standard. How can a young man keep his way pure? By keeping it according to thy word. With all my heart I have sought thee. Do not let me wander from thy commandments. Thy word have I treasured in mine heart that I might not sin against thee. Blessed art thou, O Lord. Teach me thy statutes. With my lips I have told of all the ordinance of thy mouth. I rejoiced in the way of thy testimonies, as much as in all riches. I will meditate on thy precepts and regard thy ways. I shall delight in thy statutes. I shall not forget thy word. Heavenly Father, we rejoice that we can be here tonight. The Spirit of God is here, For where two or three are gathered together, and there am I in their midst, is what you said. And you said that you inhabit the praises of your people. And when we look at the scriptures on how things were done in the early New Testament church, we know that we do things completely different in so many ways. They didn't have microphones, electricity, books like this, or anything. So we would be foolish to say we do it just like they did in the New Testament, but we've done it the best way we know how. And sure, that people can pick it apart and, you know, they get tired of things and they want to do something new and all of that, but I can't think of anything better than just the people of faith gather together, sing a few songs of worship, fellowship deeply, and just study the Word of God. I can't see how anything could be better than that. Oh, we can have emotional gush, and I think that's fine as long as it's harnessed by the Word of God. As long as that emotion is grounded by the Word of God and by the heart of the Spirit of God. You didn't make us emotionless, but at the same time, you never want our emotions to bring great trouble and commotion. So we just lift ourselves to you. We just ask you just to have your willing way done in us. That's really our heart cry. You know, we can talk about styles and we can talk about projections and all kinds of different things, but it comes down to, are we being obedient to the Word of God? This morning, as we just, I tried to preach the fact that we must be born again, and it's only by faith in Jesus Christ and that alone, nothing else. I'm so grateful for that because that means that everybody can come. And it's not about our abilities, it's about our abandonment of self. And I do pray as that seed was sown this morning, whether it be through Facebook or whether it be through the preaching, and those that were here, I pray that that seed takes deep root, and I pray that it hit fertile ground, that it would grow into a mighty time of faith in a person's life. That reflection would take place, and scouring of a soul would take place. Well, that stuff that only you can do. We can't manage that. We have a hard time managing our own lives, more or less trying to make other people's lives what they ought to be. So, Holy Spirit, we depend on what you did this morning, and knowing that it's never restricted to a clock. It's restricted to your timetable, not ours. So we look forward to fruit. We thank you for Tammy coming this evening and just wanting to be a member of this church. And we recognize, Father, that you're the one that adds to the body. You're the one that brings people in. And you're giving us an abundance of people being born again, people joining this church, following through in believers' baptism and wanting to walk with you. A heart cry and a hunger for the Word of God and fellowship. We thank you so much for that, Father. Those are things that only you can do. And we bless you and praise you for that. We pray for this church that as we walk together in the future, that you would use us as an instrument of the righteousness of Christ. Oh, Father, how we cry out to you. Well, I went much further than I thought I would go in my praying, but we just lift this text to you and ask you for your blessing upon it in Jesus' name. Amen. Through verses 9 through 16, there's basically nine different things that the writer in this psalm talks about his connection and connectivity with the Word of God or the precepts of God. He uses a lot of different terms like he did in the first 8 verses. And I want to kind of cover some of those things, but I want to dissect this text of Scripture, and I want to really look at it. I believe that, you know, we could do a topical sermon on these verses of Scripture, but I think an exposition of Scripture is so much more important because it really gives you the meat, it gives you something to dig into, it gives you fertile soil to dig your roots deep into. And he starts off, it's broken out here in this question. He asks a question. And he says, how can a young man keep his way pure? What a valuable question that a person has. If I'm ever asked to speak in a valedictory address anymore, or baccalaureate, isn't that what they do at high school? What is it called at high school? Baccalaureate service, and speak at that again. I've been asked to speak once, and I said that you should never follow your heart, and I've never been asked to speak at it again, but because the heart of man is weak and who can know it. But I would like to start off by asking this question. How can a young person keep their way pure? And you know, as far as I'm concerned, Fanny is a young person in the eyes of God. And she just turned 90. So we can say that this is a person. This is a question every person that we should ask. This question, how can I keep my way pure? We often look at other people's lives and say, I think that Barbara can do this to make her life more pure, and Billy could do this, and Ethan can do, you know, we look at other people's lives and say, we see the impurity in people's lives, and we can point that out. But I think it'd be wise for us to take a good long look in a mirror and say, how can the person in the mirror keep their way pure? To keep their way pure. The very question states, has the premise of the fact that there's basically two ways. There's a pure way and there's an impure way. That means that there's a crossroad. And I shared that out of the book of Proverbs last week, that at every crossroads, at every Y intersection, every fork in the road, every open door, wisdom and understanding are there crying out. They're screaming out for everybody to hear. And so we don't walk in ignorance. We walk in light of wisdom and understanding of the Holy Spirit of God. They're always there. And so we need to be praying more for fellowship rather than transmission. You follow the difference? We pray that God gives us wisdom. Well, it's there. We need to not pray for transmission of wisdom. We need to pray for action of wisdom, to take that wisdom and take that understanding and apply it to our lives. And so this man says, how can a young man keep his way pure? And again, there's just so many different words that can be used. And the idea there of purity. Chris and I were talking about changing the oil in the hydraulic, the oil filter and the fuel filter and the hydraulic filter in a tractor just before church started. And the reason why a filter is put there is not to obstruct anything. It's not to make it cumbersome, although I do think an engineer ought to have to work on it after he places the stuff where it's placed. But you got to be a contortionist to change some of those things, especially on a helicopter, but that's nonetheless. But a filter is put there for one reason, basically one reason, and that's to keep the oil or the fuel pure, to remove impurities that get there somehow, some way. Always has amazed me how a system that's fully enclosed, I got it on now, Charlie, how a system fully enclosed can get stuff in it. I don't know how that happens other than internal wear and tear and things like that. But the filter is very important. And so it's almost asking this question, how can I keep the impurities out of my life? How can I do that? And the impurities can come in from multiple different ways. It can come in through every gate that we have. It can come in through our ear gate, come in through our eye gate, come in through where we put our feet. You know the little song, be careful little eyes, be careful little ears, be careful little feet, and all of those kinds of things. In fact, I just read a little thing on, somebody posted something, be very careful what you listen to and who you listen to, because soon you'll become what you've listened to and who you've listened to. You got to be very careful. And so this man here in this text, this person, let's just say this person, I want to have purity in my life. I want, how can I put that filter in my life to make sure that the vital juices of my life remain pure? Which automatically lends itself to the fact that as we walk in this way, there will always be impurities that we have to deal with in our lives. I love 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The cleansing part of that text of Scripture is removing the impurities. So imagine your life, the very essence and the very thing that courses through life. Of course, we know that it's the blood, the life is in the blood. Coursing through not just your body, but through your life, that which flows through your life. How can I make sure that everything in my life remains pure? How can I get those things out of my life that make my life impure? And then he gives the answer. The filter, he says, is by keeping it according to your word. And I love the according, because that means that there's a standard. It's an arrangement of things. I think often of somebody, it was a comedy show or a good movie. They were trying to put a puzzle together and they were confused because this puzzle piece just didn't fit, and somebody came up with a hammer and they said, now it fits. They beat it into the hole and they made it fit, even though it wasn't meant to fit. When he says, I keep it according to thy word, listen, the word is solid and secure and immutable. It means it doesn't change. The word of God doesn't change. The truth of the Word of God is always the same, regardless of time, regardless of community, regardless of culture, regardless of epoch of time. It doesn't matter. The truth of Scripture is always, 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 never changes. Me, on the other hand, and you, on the other hand, we're the clay. We're the malleable. We're the moldable aspect of it. And he says, if I want to keep my life pure, my way pure, the way of my living pure, then my life must not just come alongside, but it must be pressed into and it must conform to what the Word of God says, a conformity to the standard according to your word is what he's talking about here. Place my life inside of the Word of God. Think about doing laundry. You take a soiled piece of linen, a soiled clothing, and you put it into a washing machine, as we do today, and it goes in dirty, and it gets swished around to a degree, soap gets added and all of that other stuff, and it comes out clean. It's the same garment. It's just something was removed from the garment, and that's the soil, that's the dirt, that's the impurity that's done. And when you allow the Word of God, the Bible, to come into our lives, it comes in as a cleansing agent to purify us and to take those impurities out of our lives. I've studied the Bible now for a very long time, a very, very long time. And I love the wonder of the fact that the Word of God constantly teaches me something on a regular basis that I never considered before, purifying me and drawing me closer into the ways of God. So he understands that there's a way that there's impurities that come into his life, and the only way to purify that, the only way to cleanse that, the only way to filter that is to come alongside the standard of what God has said in his word. And then he says, how blessed are those who observe his testimonies. By keeping the court of thy word. With all my heart I've sought you. Verse 10, I got a little bit confused there. With all my heart I have sought you. First thing that he said out of the nine is a seeking. He sought him in verse 10. With all my heart I have sought you. And this idea is to seek something out that's required in life. To seek something out that's required in life. Today, it's deer season, and people get up at all kinds of ungodly hours, go out into all kinds of inclement weather to seek out one thing, and that's the prize deer, the prize buck right now. They're looking for that. And so they go to great extremes to seek out that animal so that they can have that animal. And the idea there is they've given everything they've got. They've given up comfort. They've given up all kinds of different things so that they could be sitting in a tree like a bird with a gun and hope they don't fall out when they go to sleep. Right? That's why they tie themselves in. They secure themselves in. But it's a seeking. And then if you watch any nature shows or anything like the hunting shows, they'll say, I'm going to sit here and I'm going to glass the area. And what that means, they're just going to take binoculars and they're going to seek the horizon looking for the prize of their prey. They want to get that prize. So they seek it out. It means they're looking and they're searching for something. And for us, this is the important thing, is that we search the Scriptures. God, listen, it never intimidates God for us to look into the Scriptures and ask questions. It doesn't bother the Father. It doesn't rock him on his throne. He has the answer. The problem is when the answer is tried to be twisted, and many times people take Scripture out of context to conform Scripture to lifestyle. We see that today, do we not? Taking Scripture out of context, all love is real love. That's out of context. That's not Scripture. And we can go on and on about all kinds of social sins, but we do the same thing in Christian life. We use the Scriptures as a pretext for us to be able to prove something that we want done. We eisegete instead of exegete. We put something into the Scriptures instead of taking something out of the Scriptures. And that's a very hazardous thing to do. But when a sincere person comes before the Word of God and seeks the Word of God, and I think that reading, and I try to do this on a daily basis, just a casual reading. I just want to read. Somebody once said a long time ago that Billy Graham reads one. He reads through the Psalms once a week, and I thought that'd be a great idea. So I've tried to read through the Psalms once a week in a general sense, in a general way. You know, that way you could read the Psalms 52 times in a year. I think that would be a great thing. But I would do that casually. Now, when I study for a message, when I study for Sunday school, when I study for all the other times that I teach or I preach, I don't study. I don't casually read the Scriptures. I study the Scriptures. I get my tools out and I mine. I dig down. And that's really what he's saying here, is that we're supposed to search the Scriptures. That's what the Bereans did, isn't it? They listened to a message and then they went home and they studied the Scriptures to see if those things weren't so. Don't ever take my word for it because I spoke it from this pulpit or from something else. Go home and search it out and see if it's not so for yourself in the Scriptures. But search the Scriptures. Hang the commentary. Search the Scriptures. Search the Scriptures to see if those things are not so. That's grounding yourself back to the standard, the according to of the Scriptures. And so he says, with all my heart, I have sought thee. That's the first thing he did. And listen, I think this is a wonderful thing. He says, do not let me wander. I think of that song says, prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the one I love. That one stanza, it may not be exactly theologically correct, but I'll tell you what, it's really, I can connect with it. How about you? Prone to wander. Lord, how I feel that. You know, kind of leave the one that you love. Well, the word wander there, it has the idea, it has the flavor of ignorantly going in the wrong direction. Now let that, so this is something that I learned as I studied this out for tonight. I never understood it from that. I always understood it from a place of knowledge. I know what the Scripture says, and therefore I'm going to do what the Scripture says. I never saw it until I studied it out for this message that the word wander there is not a volitional act of purpose on my heart. It's the fact that I might do something or not do something in absolute ignorance without knowing that it's wrong, without knowing that I should have done what was right and didn't do what was right. You see the difference? If somebody does it in full knowledge, when the Scripture is very clear, thou shalt not commit adultery, that's pretty clear cut. But then when you discover that maybe you've done something that God's Word is, in essence, is saying that you should not be a part of, and then you realize that you've done it, I didn't know any better. The psalmist is saying, I want you, will you protect me from doing in ignorance what you don't want done in my life? And some people call it, and I think it's a bonus thing, put a hedge of protection around me. Oftentimes we say that hedge of protection is to keep the enemy from invading my life. But that hedge of protection has a twofold emphasis to it. Yes, a protection from onslaught from outside to come within, but also the hedge of protection to keep the cattle in the right field. Father, put a hedge of protection around me to protect me from the wolves that come in sheep's clothing, but also protect me from going further than I ought to go, than going somewhere where I don't belong. Because I'm a sheep, that means I don't think very much. I need a shepherd. So when he's saying, help me, how shall a young man keep his way pure? That's how do I keep myself and follow the according of the Word of God. And then he says, please help me not to wander. I don't want to volitionally do something wrong, but I don't want to ignorantly do something at the same time. You follow that? That's the idea of wander. I don't want to wander from your commands. And I love listen, commands never bothered me. They never bother me. I'd much rather hear a command of God than a suggestion of humanity. I'd rather hear God say, this is what I want. Thus saith the Lord, I know I'm in good shape. If I do what he says, it doesn't matter what anything else happens, does it? If you do what the Creator says to do, you're in good standing, you're in good shape. When you do what's right, you're not wrong, no matter what anybody says, no matter what happens. Even though it may throw you into an emotional turmoil for months and months and months, you've still not done wrong if you've done what God said to do. Amen? So that's the key thing that's going on here, the command. I'm not afraid. I'm not going to run from the commandments of God. He's not talking about the Ten Commandments, although that's part of it. That's just 10 of them. There's many things in the Scriptures. And then he goes a little bit further. You can see this great progression. It's a depth that goes down into the inner part of his soul, the heart of his heart. And he says, with all my heart. And by the way, the word heart there, and we talked about it last week, if you remember what it means the center control unit of who you are, your internal authority. That's what the word heart there means. It's not a passion. It's not a romanticism. It's not a sappy Hallmark card. It's not the heart. It's the center of the authority of your life, your main central authority. And so he's saying, with all of the central authority inside of me, I want to seek you. With all of my heart, I seek you out. And don't let me wander from your commandments. And then he says, your word. Now this is the spoken word. And this is the revealed written word of God. And I think it's interesting. I just want to throw this out very quickly. There's a word, rhema, R-H-E-M-A is the Greek word, rhema. It's a cool word. It's a wonderful word. It means it's a fresh word. It's something that God gives fresh kind of thing. There's so many people that are wanting rhemas. I remember a fellow, he says, I just want a rhema from God every day. And I thought to myself, but do you get into the revealed written word of God every day? The thing about the written word of God is it's secure. It's there. You have it tangible right here. And for some reason, people think that a rhema, which doesn't happen very often, is more spiritual than this word here. Let me tell you something. The word of God is spiritual no matter where it comes from. This is sufficient for all matters of faith and practice, for living, for dying, for finances, for family, for everything in life. The word of God is complete. God saw to that. We use other aspects to help us with that. That's why he gives us teachers. That's why spiritual gift of teaching is so prolific in churches. When you do a spiritual gifting exam of a church, you'll find that two spiritual gifts stand out above all else. One is shepherding and one is teaching. Those two gifts stand out more prolific in the body of believers than nearly any other gift. You know why? Because every good Sunday school teacher is also a good Sunday school shepherd. They take care of those that are in their charge to teach the Word of God. The shepherd is not just the pastor. The pastor is the over-shepherd. But every Sunday school teacher, every person that teaches the Word of God to others also usually carries, in tandem, the gift of shepherding if they've got the gift of teaching. Because in the gift of teaching, there's grave responsibility. And you care. If you don't care for those people that you teach, you need to stop teaching. Amen?
Amen.
You need to care deeply for I think about the deacons. We gather together on Sunday mornings and we pray for the Sunday school teachers and the things that are going on. And this morning Mark was praying, and I listen to what people pray, by the way. I don't pick it apart. I listen and it just deposits in my mind. He prayed that God would give the teachers wisdom and grace and kindness as they proclaim the Word of God to the students that God has given to them. I can't think of a better prayer to pray for on Sunday morning for our Sunday school teachers than that prayer. From the weeest tots to the oldest ones. We need that wisdom, do we not? We need that grace to teach. And that every teacher has the heart of a shepherd. To think, how is this word going to infect? How is it going to reflect? How is it going to improve the life of those that hear it? You know, people come to something because there's... people come to a dinner table because there's food worthy to eat. And out of all people, should the teachers of the Word of God not do the best they possibly can to prepare the best meal they can to those who voluntarily come to hear the Word of God? And a good shepherd-hearted teacher wants the very best for those that listen to him. They're not as concerned about numbers as they are about feeding those that come and feeding them well. And so here, this is, he says, your word, and I love this, your word have I treasured. It means to store up in a hiding place for initial and future discovery. For initial and future discovery. I don't have a lot of in my life, but ever when I get a little bit extra money, I don't have a whole lot. I don't have a whole lot, believe me. But I like to buy, when I can, maybe an ounce or two of silver, and I've never been able to buy an ounce of gold. It's about $2,000 an ounce, and I just can't afford that. But, you know, I was buying silver when it was $3 an ounce. Everybody can afford an ounce of silver. Now it's about $24 an ounce. But I bought it because I like it, and I really don't have a whole lot of it. But I have it, and that piece of silver that I paid $3.40 with over 25 years ago is now worth quite almost 10 times as much. So I bought it as a treasure because it was worth something at the time, knowing that in the future, the value will increase. Now think about what the scripture says here, and you can do it with anything. People speculate on property. There's people that buy land, am I right? They invest in property, correct? They buy real estate. Do they buy real estate just so that they can lose money, or do they buy real estate as an investment so that later on it will garner more? Isn't that basically the idea there if you're an investor in that? If you're an investor in the stock market, you can buy stocks at $4 a share, hoping that it'll get to $20 a share when you retire. You're investing to build. It's value initially, but then it builds value when it's cashed in. It always constantly builds value. That's the idea. That's the utopia. And when he says thy word, your word, the things that you say, your directives, your commandments, I treasure in my heart. That means that I've received them the way that you've given them, knowing that there's direct application in my life as I receive it. And also I know that it's going to come to a greater value in the future, meaning that the truth isn't restricted to one aspect of time in my life. But that same truth will apply in the future and be worth more in other events and aspects of my life yet to come. And so we're building, if you will, a thesaurus of the treasure of the Word of God inside of our lives. That's what we're doing. That's what we're doing. The value increases in our lives. It's not just a life preserver that helps us in a moment. It's a lifeboat that floats us the rest of our lives, and every time it comes into contact with us, it increases in value. That's the idea of treasure, that it's not something that's just a one-time firecracker event, but it constantly builds in value. And again, he uses the word heart, which means the internal authority of your life. It's the authority inside of who you are. The authority that I have builds this value of the Word of God. And the reason why, and listen, when you begin to allow the Word of God to become the influencer of the internal authority inside of you, you'll begin to understand, I think, more. We'll never completely understand. We'll begin to understand things of God that we never comprehended before. Honestly, we know that God loves us, right? And we camp out on that in which it's undeniably true, for God so loved the world. Amen. But what about the righteousness of God? And what about the holiness of God? Do we begin to capture that nearly as much as we've captured the love of God? Well, when you're in the Word of God, the holiness of God begins to be preeminent to us. The love of God certainly will continue to grow, and our understanding of that will continue to grow. But we will begin to understand that God is a righteous God, and that God is a holy God, and God is a sovereign God. And we'll begin to understand that it's more than just one aspect of God, but it's similar to the idea of a multifaceted diamond. It's the same stone, but it has so many different placid cuttings on it, different facets on it, same stone. And when we are in the Word of God, we'll begin to understand some of the grandeur of who God is. I was listening to a message the other day, and it was talking about wickedness, and it was talking about evil, and it was talking about demonic influences and different things like that. And I thought about a fellow that we were doing a Bible study one time when I was up in Anchorage in the dorm. We would do a lot of Bible studies in my dorm room. And we were talking about evil spirits. We were talking about demons and different things like that. And about 2 o'clock in the morning, my phone rang. And it was literally a landline. You know, we didn't have cell phones back then. There was no such thing. It was literally a landline. And we had a party line in the dorm, so there was two or three of us that used the same line. My phone rang about 2 o'clock, and I answered it, and it was a guy that we did the Bible study with, and he said, I can't sleep. And I said, well, I can't now. Why? Why did you call me to tell me that and wake me up? He said, because of what we talked about. I said, what do you mean? He said, I'm scared to death. He said, I'm scared to death of the demonic influence that may be around me. And we talked about that, and he was finally, you know, I shared more scripture with him and things like that, but that stuck with me like it was a huge event to me. And this is what amazes me more than anything else. When Christians do a study, most of the time, not every time, this is not absolute, and you talk about demons and you talk about the spiritual warfare and all of that, there's a lot of Christians that will be afraid then because of demonic influences. They'll be afraid of what a demon can do. It stuns me that the holiness of God doesn't bring a fear of God like studying a demon who's already destined to hell for all of eternity, is already lost, brings fear into people's lives. That the fear of God doesn't seem to exist in a lot of people's lives. But boy, you talk about a demon, we're scared to death. We're afraid to go out in the dark because a haint may get us. But yet we'll dance around on the holiness of God in a party and not be concerned about how we look or how what we say, thinking the blood of Jesus will take care of it all, and we just seem to avoid the fear of God. I tell you, I believe that a Christian ought to be more afraid of God than a demon. There ought to be a great fear and a great reverence of God is what it ought to be. And when we study the Word of God, we'll begin to see that more and more. The treasure of that becomes more clear to us in that great sense. It says, I treasure these mountains. And when we do that, then we begin to understand the depth of our sin. See, when we sin, and the Scriptures talks about that we sin against the body. Fornication and adultery is a sin against your body. You do know that. That's what the Scripture says. But there's other sins. We can sin against a brother by lying about him. We can sin against a sister by, you know, doing something you ought not do or whatever it might be. But have you ever understood that sin is against the holiness of God more than it is against anything else? And isn't it interesting? And he said, thy word have I treasured in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Our sin against the Father. The blood of Jesus Christ didn't galvanize God from our sin. Understand that. The blood of Jesus Christ paid the penalty of our sins. And we should take our sins as serious as we can possibly take our cancer in our bodies if it ever comes. I don't know anybody that prays that cancer, that they get a note from the doctor says, I got to tell you, you got cancer in your body. And they say, well, it's just a little cell, just a couple of cells. It's not a big deal. Well, you know that person is destined to die if that's the view they take of small cancer cells. Am I not right? People do everything within their power to even the cutting off of different aspects of their body to get rid of cancer. Isn't that correct? Because they don't want one cell of cancer in their body. Because they know it can multiply, it will multiply, and it will lead to death every time. And that's why we're so concerned about it. When somebody prays for Dwayne, I put it on the phone tree, Bill and Joyce's son, Dwayne. You know, the good news, I didn't get to tell everybody this. He went through the PET scan, everything like that. There's no sign of cancer in his body. Isn't that wonderful? I happen to believe that there could have been, and God just decided to take it out when God's people prayed. I do believe that prayer is powerful. I don't believe they just missed it. I believe it could have been there and God took it out. I'm a fool to believe it, I know, but I'd rather be a fool believing that than the circumstances. But if we would be that concerned over one cell of cancer and this tiniest, you'd have to use a microscope to see it. Understand that. The naked eye can't see a cell of cancer. Why do sins not bother us, the smallest of sins? Because every sin will lead to death. Should we not be concerned about sin in our lives? We're very concerned that God blesses us. When Jeremiah was writing about the destruction of Israel, he mentioned the fact that God's men were telling the children of Israel in Jerusalem, you've got to repent and you've got to turn back to God and you've got to forsake these things. And they didn't listen to him. They didn't listen to them. And Jeremiah says, after destruction came and they went into Babylonian captivity, Jeremiah said, do you know that you guys, I'm paraphrasing this, do you know that you guys chose to listen to people who were false teachers instead of the truth tellers? You chose to believe something that was not so because it fits your fancy rather than believe what was told by men of God. And look at what it led to. It led to disaster in your life. Jerusalem is now a wreck, he says, because you listen to false teachers. You know, you can get on the internet and you can listen to guys, and you'll never hear some of those men ever talk about righteousness and purity and holiness. You'll never hear it. You'll never hear them talk about sin because they don't want to offend anybody with sin. I would rather be guilty of bringing an offense to someone talking about sin and seeing them get right with God than to just kind of dance around it and placate it and just kind of fanciful it and know that they're destined for destruction because you didn't deal with it. That would be a derelict of duty. And so the psalmist says, I don't want anything in my life against you. You are preeminent in everything in your word. Please don't even let me err in ignorance against you. The word of God gave him a higher value and a higher view of who God is. And then verse 12, he just burst into praise, if you would. Blessed art thou, O Lord. And then when he blesses the Lord, and I'm probably reading into it, but it just seems like a natural thing right here. His questioning and then his description of the word and how he treasured it and things like that threw him into a great burst of blessing to the Lord. And then he says, he begins to understand his great need. He not only says, I sought you, not only do I treasure you, he says, I'm going to learn from you. Because he says in his verse of scripture, in verse 12, teach me thy statutes. Teach me these things. And the idea of teaching is a directing of the path of my life in accordance with the way that you want me to go. That's what that is about. It's the idea comes from the Hebrew text, the Hebrew word of leading an ox with the direction it's supposed to go. It would be with a prod or a stick with a sharp edge, you know, maybe a blunted edge, but something that would prod the ox into the right direction. Because an ox, if you let an ox go, it'll just go wherever it wants to go, wherever it pleases to go. But when somebody is standing behind the ox, they want the ox to go in the right place. If the ox begins to go this way, they take that stick and they fiddle around with it. Prod the animal to go in a different direction. It's a prodding. And when he says, teach me, he's saying, God, take the instrument that you choose to make sure that I go in the right direction. Keep me from the wrong direction. Let me say this. The wrong direction for me may be the right direction for you. But it will never go against the word of God. So when I, you know, he talks about, well, I don't want to wander. Make sure that I go in the right direction there. So would you do that for me? Teach me. And the idea of statutes, I think this is a fabulous word. It's the idea of a coming together. I believe in divine appointments. I don't know if you're familiar with the term divine appointments, but you have divine appointments all the time in your life. Do you know that? And everybody has divine appointments with the Word of God, with truth. And so what he's saying is, I want you to teach me, I want you to prod me in the way that I'm supposed to go. Bring me to that beautiful divine appointment of your word of God to me. Marry us together according to what you want me to do. Listen, God's word will always be the direction for your life. Always. And he divinely intercedes in our lives with the word of God and shows us and directs us the way that we're supposed to go. I use too many personal illustrations, but I was told that I can't talk about family anymore. So I have to use these. I was begging God for what he wanted me to do in sincere honesty. And in a regular reading of the Word of God, he said, if thou return to me, I will restore you. If you are the worthy, not worthless words, you will be as my spokesman. In that moment, I'm in a dormitory up in Anchorage, Alaska, at Elmendorf Air Force Base. The Holy Spirit of God took that word from God and implanted it inside of me, and I knew immediately that God was calling to be a spokesman for me. I knew that I was being called to preach and to pastor God's people. He took the word of God and gave me a divine appointment with the word of God, and my desire, he prodded them and glued them together, and it stuck with me for the last 40 years. That's why I can't give up preaching. That's why I cannot give up pastoring. Is because God's word directed me to do it. If I didn't have a word from God, from the revealed written word of God, I would have given up a long time ago. A man is a fool who tries to do this without a word from God. I tried one time, and God said, I'll let you try it. Sure, go ahead, have a ball. Go ahead and swim with that lead swimsuit. Go ahead and see how far you get. Lasted for about a month. I said, dear God, if you ever put me back in a pulpit, I'll never leave. And he was gracious to me. So it's been sufficient for me for 40 years. Next Sunday will be 40 years. I will have been ordained and in the pastorate ministry for 40 years next Sunday. And it's because God has put me there by the word of God. I'm convinced that whether it's a homemaker, whether it's a plumber, whether it's an electrician, a farmer, a mailman, whatever it might be, God's word will direct you exactly where he wants you to be. And when you're in God's word, you'll be exactly where you need to be. And you can hold on to that when there's nothing else to hold on to. In fact, it's the only thing to hold on to, amen, is the word of God. So he says, teach me your statutes. Bring those wonderful divine appointments into my life. Now, I will tell you this, that those divine appointments sometimes are few and far between. And you know what you do? If you just get addicted to God's saying and then you do it, you know, that, then you live for that instead of living for him. You see the difference? One word from God should be sufficient for the rest of your life. I love what Henry Blackaby says. When you don't know what to do, do what God last told you to do until he tells you to do something else. Do that which God has told you to do. Until he tells you to do something else. How long is that? Well, however long it takes for him to tell you to do something else. That's how long you do it. And so, he says in verse 13, with my lips I have told all the ordinances of the mouth. So the next thing we see that he does, he testifies. And that's what I did tonight. I testified to the things that God has done in my life. And I know that you could give testimony to what he does in your life. I proclaim with my mouth. There's something that's being said about what God has said. In the idea of his ordinances, and the idea of ordinance there is the rulings over, the judgments of God and the ways of God as you've seen in your life. You look back and you say, I can see how God's word changed me there and directed me here and did this and did that. It's very clear. And I want to talk about what God did in my life. There's nothing wrong with testifying. Everybody's got a testimony if they follow the word of God. And so I must race to the next one. In verse 14, I have rejoiced in the way of thy testimonies. So the idea here is that there's a rejoicing inside of that, that he talks about here. And it almost is a deliverance idea. It's the idea that's connected with chrysalis. You're familiar with the word chrysalis? I think I've got the right word. The caterpillar goes inside the cocoon. And it's called chrysalis, I believe, isn't that right? When the butterfly comes out, or the moth, whatever it might be, that's the idea here. It's not a deliver. Listen, it's not a deliverance necessarily from something; it's a transformation into something. And there's a difference. The Word of God is never an escape hatch from stuff; it's a transformation in the middle of stuff. A chrysalis coming in one way. Let me tell you something. There's people in this room right here that could stand up and testify for hours about God putting them in a tough situation and they come out a whole lot different than they went in. Do I have an amen? Amen. And 99.9% of the time, if not 100% of the time, it's because of a divine intervention and God divinely changed us and conformed us more to the image of Christ. Is that not correct? I'm more like Christ. How many people have ever said, my prayer life is always better when I'm in the midst of what? Crisis or trouble. Am I right? God brings us to those moments to where we have to depend on Him in those powerful ways. And that's the idea of that he's giving here, the rejoicement. I see a change in my life. I believe the scariest thing for me in my few years of life as a Christian is, God, I don't ever want to stop conforming to the image of Christ. I don't ever want to think that I've arrived somewhere. I want to be on that continual journey in Christ. Take me further than I would never go on my own, but take me where You want me to go. Change whatever needs to be changed in my life, but take me further than I would ever go without You. And then He says, not only did I rejoice in Thy testimonies, it was more meaningful to me than all the riches that the world, and I think about George Bailey Shaw, I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. There's nothing that compares to the joy of following Him. And then He says, I will meditate. That's the next thing, to meditate. And the idea of meditation, and I love this, there's a book, and Bill Hybels' book, The Purpose-Driven Life, that's what it is. And I think it was Bill Hybels that wrote that, wasn't it, Bill Hybels? Who was that? It was, huh? Rick Warren wrote it. I don't agree with a lot of things Rick Warren said, but I went through the 40 days of his book there, and he said something in a book that really stuck with me. Every blind hog finds an acre now and again, you know? And every time a preacher will say something that's worthy to remember, he said that if you can, there's one thing that a lot of people say, well, I just worry all the time, I just worry. And when there's nothing to worry about, I worry because there's nothing to worry about. You know what I'm talking about. People say, I worry all the time. Help me to not worry. And he said something about that. He says, do you know that if you can worry, you can meditate? Because worry is meditation misplaced. Let that soak in. That's a powerful statement. Worrying is meditation misplaced. Meditation means you're swept away in the thought of it. Now, it's not the same thing as sitting around with your legs crossed like you can as a young person. You can't do it as an old person in the Indian seat, you know. Om. It's not that at all. It's being swept up into the truth and reality of what God has spoken and written in His Word. And just be swept up in the beauty of that with Him. That's the idea of meditation. I'll be swept up away from God. And you say, how do you, you know, I've never had that experience. Have you ever been in love with a young person? I even think Billy was probably in love with Glenda. I think Glenda might have been in love with him. I'm not sure. some of you have been in love for so long, but you remember what it was like when you first fell in love with the person that you just really spent the rest of your life with? You couldn't eat, you couldn't sleep. You know what I'm talking about? I remember the thought I was sick. No, I was just in love. And then I met Vicky and realized what love really was. You know what I'm saying? And you just think about him all the time. All the time, where you can't even eat, you can't sleep, you can't do your job the way you're supposed, because you got your caught. That's called meditation, and you're caught up in your thought, and your thoughts are always just filtered towards that individual that you're just captured by. And this is what the psalmist says: I am captured by the things of God's Word, and I want them to be over and over and over in my mind. I know that it's just an old preacher thing to say, but guys, we need to be careful what we allow our minds to be meditated on. Paul said this in the book of Philippians. Whatsoever things are good and pure and wholesome, think on these things. Meditate on these things. Give your mind to those things. Why? Because that's what the Word of God says that we're supposed to do. That's why these things that people watch on TV are foolishness. And songs that people listen to are utter foolishness. It's a waste of divinity, of divine time. Give ourselves to the meditation of the Word of God. He says, I'll meditate on all the precepts. And remember, precepts is like a building block. One precept over another, the building blocks of righteousness in the life of a believer. I'll meditate on what You say of Your Word and how it affects in my life. And I will regard Your ways. The idea of regarding His ways, I'm going to meditate And then I'll meditate on your precepts and regard your ways. It means that I will consider and I will make a definitive decision to respect what you say. I like what I used this illustration last week. I like Sherlock Holmes, and he says, Dr. Watson, you see, but you do not perceive. You know, it's one thing to hear the word of God, another thing to say, you know, God, I regard your word, I hear your word, and I regard it, and I respect it. I respect your word. I believe for a parent, what's more important for a parent, for their children to respect them more than it is to just gushly love them. Because a child does not understand the value of love to begin with. But a child will respect a parent and do what that parent says because they respect the parent, even if they don't understand it. Love says, you'll let me. Love is like for a grandparent, not for a parent. Stanley knows what I'm talking about. But a child that does not respect their parent will never listen to their parent. Amen? You can hear the word of God, and if you don't regard it, consider it, and then decide, I'm going to respect what God says. You'll never follow the word of God if you don't respect it. Give it time, consider it. Yes, consider it. But if you don't respect it, you'll never follow it. And that's what he says here. I'm going to respect the word of God. And then because of that, the last two things, and we'll be done. And I got 2 minutes to do it. I shall delight in thy statutes. Now there, as many times as I have talked about that emotions are not the driving engine of a Christian's life, they are the comfort seat in the coach. It means that I get a lot of joy and happiness out of following the Word of God. There's times that I sit back and I think, am I glad I followed your word? And I feel an emotion of relief, an emotion of joy, because I didn't do something stupid, but I did what I was supposed to according to the word of God. So he says that I will delight. It's a joyful thing in a person's life. It's not that you go around sucking sour persimmons and say, I followed the word of God. It's the fact that you walk around with a smile on your face and a spring in your step. And say, the word of God is that important to me. And then he says, that it's kind of in a negative sense. It's a negative positive, if you would. He said, I shall not forget thy word. I've made up my mind. I'm not going to forget your word. I will not forget. And the idea, and again, sometimes these words come in a sense that, let me give you a good illustration with this. It's the idea of hiding something that you don't want to follow. When I was pastoring over at Dixie Hills Baptist Church, there was a family, just a precious family. Love them to death. They're still dear, dear friends to us. And they took a foster child. And he was kind of a rambunctious little boy, you know. And that's being kind. And he was a foster child. And he got in a lot of trouble at school. And the teacher sent a note home with him. And when Monroe opened up the backpack of the little boy, he found the note, and he read the note, and he said, boy, and Monroe's just kind of a rough, tough kind of guy, a good guy. He said, if I get another note like this from the teacher, you're in deep trouble, and I mean, do you understand me? And when he said that, Monroe had just the kind of guy that you just shrink if he said that. You know, I don't understand everything. Well, I'll never forget. Monroe was telling me he came to church one night, and he told me about that. And then he said, let me tell you what happened the next day. Well, he came home and he had a note in his backpack. And the boy, he knew that if Monroe read the note, he was in trouble. So he thought he'd hide the truth. So he left his backpack on the bus. And he walked around the bus, and there was Monroe at the door, and he was going like this, and the bus driver yelled out the window, hey, son, you forgot your backpack. And he said, no, no, no. I'm holding the backpack out the window. He didn't want the backpack to come to Monroe. So he was trying to hide the truth. Friends, listen, when we have the truth, don't hide it because you're afraid of what will happen. Apply it so that you know the good things of God are in your life. Thy word have I treasured in mine heart, that I might not sin against you. Beth, hallelujah for Psalm 119. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for tonight. Just the joy and the happiness and the fellowship that's in this room. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. Father, we've witnessed that you've added to the church tonight. Hallelujah. Praise your name. Thank you that we're not dead. We are alive in Christ. And we have a hope and a future in Christ Jesus. And we bless you and praise you for that. And so as we're dismissed now and go to our homes and get ready to go to work tomorrow and all the other things, I just pray that we would just have a different view of the Word of God. A hunger, that you would put a hunger and a thirst for you like never before. We bless you and praise you. We honor you and thank you for all you do in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Be sure to make your way back there to Tammy and welcome her into the body.